Ông quý chú. Ông nói chung là cả mình to cái tầm nào cả này tệ thì tạm nào cả. Mình to tầm này phát đạo bình thường chung từ phía kỳ xã Bình Nhá. Rồi mình thạm bởi vì nó mốc đồng nàng đang mà đang rộng nít. Nên bây mình nói cả mình to cả tăng thông rộng đào dịp vô. Nó xả xây nì.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon, Mr. Witness. I'll be picking up. Can you hear me? I'll be picking up where my colleague left off this morning. You were talking about a leader from the North Zone who came with Kai Pak to the first January dam, whose name was Chon. Mr. Witness, we have a document in evidence, E3-2165, which is a list from S21 of prisoners from the Old North Zone or Central Zone. Number 21 on that list is a person named Khom Chon alias Chon, who is identified as the Secretary of Sector 43. My question to you, was your district, Santuk District, part of Sector 43 of the North Zone? And does this refresh your recollection that the person named Chon, who you saw at the first January dam work site, was the leader of Sector 43?
I'm asking you about the person named Chon, who was with Kai Pak at the first January dam site. Do you remember, was this person Chon, was he the secretary or leader of Sector 43 of the North Zone?
Mr. Witness, do you remember a period where the local leaders of the Khmer Rouge in the North Zone were arrested or disappeared and were replaced by people from the Southwest Zone? Let me read something as part of your testimony in your OCIJ interview, D-166-156, it's document again, D-166/156, ERN Khmer 00321785, English 00330718, French 00402981. This is what you testified in your OCIJ interview. Quote, I do not remember the name of the commune chiefs
in the Khmer Rouge regime, but they were all taken to be killed. End of quote. And at the start of the very next page of your interview, in describing a district combatant unit in which you worked, you stated, and I quote, "The unit chairmen were killed in the Khmer Rouge regime." End of quote. Can you please tell us what happened to these local cadres in your area, such as the commune chiefs and unit chairmen, who you testified were killed during the Khmer Rouge regime? When did this take place? Was this while you were working at the first January dam, before you went to the first January dam, or after you were working at that dam? Can you tell us when it was that they killed these people? And who was it that replaced the commune chiefs and unit chairmen who were killed? Were these people from your area, or were these people who came from a different part of the country? Were any of them cadres from the southwest zone, from either Takao or Kampot? I want to go back to the first January dam and ask you a few questions to clarify a little bit about the role of your commune, Kampong Tama, in the construction of the first and sixth January dams. Is it correct that your commune, Kampong Tama, was bordered on the south by the Stung Chanit River and on the north by the Tang Krasang River? Is that correct?
Stung Chanit Khang Thabong Wat Kupung Thmo
What about the Tang Krasang River? Was that in your commune or was that in a different part of Santuk district? And in addition to the dam and bridge that was being built on the Stung Chinit, were there canals being built throughout your commune, Kampon Thama? Do you remember how many people from your commune were working on the first January dam? Was it most of the people from the commune or just a small number of people from the commune?
ក្រុមឃុំទាំងអស់គឺក្នុងស្រុកសន្ទុកមូលកម្លាំងរាប់ម៉ឺនអ្នកក្នុងស្រុកទាំងមូលកម្លាំងធ្វើទំនុកមួយមករានៅក្នុងស្រុកសន្ទុកបាទកម្លាំងច្រើនណាស់ទូទាំងស្រុកសន្ទុកទាំងមូលទំនុកមួយមករា
And the workers from Santuk district that you're talking about, were they all working in your commune, Kampon Thama commune?
Thank you. I have a few follow-up questions to some of the things my colleague asked you about this morning. You said that there were small wooden latrines that were built in your part of the work site. Can you tell us what was done with the sewage or waste from those latrines? Where was it disposed of?
And my colleague read to you part of your OCIJ interview in which you testified that one of the Khmer Rouge leaders who you saw at the work site spoke over a loudspeaker and, in your words, quote, ordered the militiamen to order the people to work faster. In this testimony, you referred to militiamen at the work site. Can you please tell us who were the militiamen who were at the first January Dam work site?
Lop thiên chlo un chain hai krai me tiet chlo chlo me chran neak na
These militia, were they people at the commune level, district level, sector, or zone? And this person you identify as the chief of militia, was he chief of militia for a certain commune or a certain district? Can you tell us a little bit more about who these militia were, where they came from?
So this person that you named as the chief of militia, you're saying he was the chief of the Kampon Tom militia? Or Kampon Tama militia, do I understand correctly? What was the role of the militiamen who were at the first January Dam site? What did they do there? Did these militiamen have weapons? I'm going to come back to some more questions about the militia in a little bit. I want to turn first to another subject that you talk about in your OCIJ interview. Which is the arrests of former Yean Lon soldiers. In your interview, D-166/156, ERN references Khmer 00321786, English 00330719, French 00402982, you stated that you worked for a period as a commune militiaman in Kampon Tama, and you gave the following testimony. Question: when you were a militiaman at that time, how many people did you see arrested? Answer: I saw them arrest approximately 50 people. I believe that many of the people were accused of being policemen, soldiers, or spies. End of quote. My first question for you, how did Kampon Tama Commune go about identifying
Which people were former Yean Lon soldiers or policemen? How was it that those people were identified by the commune? Let me ask you this. When the new people arrived in your commune after 17 April 1975, were they required to provide biographies with their personal backgrounds? And when you said that many of the people arrested were policemen and soldiers, do you remember whether these were people who had certain ranks, or was anyone who was identified as a former policeman or soldier subject to arrest? And when you say if they committed a mistake, what type of mistakes are you talking about? When the commune militia arrested these former soldiers and policemen, where were they taken? In your OCIJ statement, and this is at pages Khmer 00321, 786 through 87, English 00330, 719 through 720, French 00402, 982 through 983. You discussed a security office that was located in Tabang Kaung, and you also stated that the commune militia stayed at either Khong Sao or Tabeng Khaung. My question to you, Khong Sao village, when the commune was based there, was there a commune office in Khong Sao, or where was it that the commune militia stayed when you were in Khong Sao village?
บาดอดภูมิกองอ่อนเนี่ยอดมีคุมที่กองสาวคือภูมิกองสาวอดมีฉลบคุมอุตตะนั้นภูมิกองสาวอดนี่คือภูมิกองสาวอดมีคุมกองสาวคุมคุมตะไบกองบาดในอาคาร
The translation may have got mixed up. I was referring to Khong Sao village. You indicated that the commune militia stayed there. My question was there an office in Khong Sao village where the militia stayed?
Was
Khong Sao village a big place? Did many people live there during the Khmer Rouge regime?
Did
you know a person from Khong Sao village named Ut Seng who worked at the first January dam for a period? Do you remember Ut Seng? Ut Seng lived in Khong Sao village, and he testified in this courtroom on the 2nd and 3rd of January, 2nd and 3rd of June this year. And he remembers you. He testified that most of the time he saw you working in the villages, but he confirmed that he saw you once at the first January dam work site. And let me read to you what he testified in this trial. This is from E1/309.1 at 13:55:54. This is what he testified about the time he saw you at the first January dam. Quote, I saw him pass by. He was in charge of people in Sao village, so he could walk past to the work site where his people were working. Perhaps he went there to visit his workers from Khong Sao village. End of quote. My question to you, Mr. Witness, during the time that you were commune militia based in Khong Sao village, did you visit the first January dam site to visit the workers from that village?
នៅនោះដែលបានឃើញកាលដែលធ្វើខ្ញុំនៅធ្វើទៅរែកដីនឹងឯងនៅនឹងឯងឃើញទៅរែកដីទាំងអស់គ្នាហ្នឹងឃើញបាទ
How far was Kong Sao Village from the place where you worked at the first January dam? Was it close or was it far away? I want to read another excerpt from your OCIJ interview. This is at Khmer 00321786, English 00330719, and French 00402982. This is what you testified in regards to how people were arrested during the time you were in the commune militia. Quote, "The orders to arrest people were given from the district and provincial levels. They sent a letter to Tlang, who you later identify as the commune chief, and Tlang orally gave me the order. When I arrested people, I was told the names of the people to be arrested. The people to be arrested were called to attend a meeting at the commune, and those people were tied, put into trucks, and taken to be killed." End of quote. My first question, how did you know that the arrest orders came from the district or provincial level?
ចាប់នឹងមកពីឋានៈស្រុកនឹងឋានៈខេត្តបាទគឺមិនជានឹងគឺមកពីឋានៈມັນដឹងជាឋានៈណាទេគេថាអង្គការឋានៈលើឋានៈលើគឺជំនាន់នោះគឺគេហៅអង្គការដឹងអង្គការហីតាំងឯណាអង្គការដឹងឯណាអ្នកធំដឹងឯណាតូចធំអង្គការអង្គារទាំងអស់បាទមកពីលើទំនង
And when you said that people to be arrested were called to a meeting at the commune, where exactly was it that these people were called to? Was it to the commune office, or what was the location where people who were arrested were called to go to? And where was the commune office in Kampon Thama?
ទីឃុំនឹងតើមន្ទីរឃុំកំពង់ថ្មនឹងមានទីតាំងនៅកន្លែងណាដែរនៅខាងក្រោមទនុបមួយមករាខាងជើងវត្តកំពង់ថ្មបាទស្បែងកោខាងក្រោមទនុបមួយមករា
I want to ask you now a few questions on another subject, which concerns what happened to the Cham people in your commune. In your OCIJ interview, D166156, at Khmer 00321787, English 00330719, French 00402982. You stated that there were a number of Cham who had been evacuated to your village, that some of those Cham families had been sent to other places, and others had been arrested. And I also want to read to you what Ut Seng, the person who from Kang Sao village, testified about the Cham families there. In his interview, E3-5267 at Khmer 00271411, English 00282357, French 00482935, he provided the following testimony about the Cham families who lived in Kong Sao village. Quote, the Cham people were also killed during that era. One day when I was awakening, all the Cham in my village suddenly disappeared. There were 10 Cham families in my village, and of the 10 families, just one person was still alive. At the time, she was away working in the district mobile unit. Mr. Witness, you were in the commune militia. You've indicated that, testified that there were Cham who were arrested. Can you tell us who it was that ordered the arrests of the Cham people in Kampong Tama commune?
Do you remember what year it was that this happened?
Da luk cham te tha hat ka ni kat lang ne chnam na dai.
Hat cham na ba.
Do you know whether lists were made of all the Cham people who lived in your commune before they were arrested?
Mean chmuh chun chit cham tang oh da roh na khnung khum robos luk mun pe da ke chap khluon men re te
hat dang hat dang hat skol chmuh hat dang
The last question I want to, the last subject I want to cover with you before I cede the floor to the civil parties concerns your position in the commune militia, and I want to give you an opportunity to respond to some testimony we've heard from Ut Seng. In Ut Seng's OCIJ interview at E3-5267, ERN Khmer 00271410, English 00282356-57, and French 00482935. This is what Ut Seng testified about you and your position during the Khmer Rouge regime. Quote, in the sub-district, there were security personnel who monitored. They carried clubs and knives, and the knives were covered with dry blood. So on our own, we became afraid of dying. There was a chief executioner named Lon. He had a bicycle and he carried a sword on his bicycle. Today he is living at
Khwai Village, Kampong Tama Sub-District, Santuk District. In 1979, when the Vietnamese arrived, Luân was arrested and imprisoned. End of quote. The first thing I'd like to ask you about, Mr. Witness, is it correct, Mr. Witness, that you were arrested and imprisoned by the Kampong Tom court after the Khmer Rouge regime fell in
1979?
And during the period that you were in the commune militia in Kampong Tama, what was your position? Was there any period in which you were the chief of the Kampong Tama militia?
And
Mr. Witness, in your OCIJ interview, and this is D-166/156, ERN Khmer 00321787, English 00330720, French 00402983. You stated that you, and I quote, stopped working as a militiaman in 1977 because I did not follow their orders when they ordered me to kill people. I was ordered to get on the truck with the people that they arrested and brought to the security office at Da Bang Khaung. I was ordered to kill people, but I did not obey. End of quote. Mr. Witness, in another part of your OCIJ interview on the previous page, in regards to orders you received from your commune chief to arrest people, this is what you said, quote, if I had not followed their orders when I went to arrest someone, I would have been killed. End of quote. My question for you, Mr. Witness, is the truth that in order to survive, you had to follow all the orders you received from your superiors, including orders to arrest and orders to execute?
បាទពីការនៅគឺប្រកាសធៀងចឹងមិនគឺធ្វើបើសិនថាមិនគោរពតាមវាមិនជាឲ្យបើយើងមិនធ្វើតាមខ្លួនយើងគឺអត់មានជីវិតរស់នៅទេគឺឲ្យតែនិយាយដូចថាមិនសមរម្យនឹងដឹងរឿងអុយពីវាគឺយើងនឹងមិនរស់បានទេមិនអាចរស់បានបាទអត់រស់បានទេនេះក្រុមការដឹកនាំជំនាន់ហ្នឹងគឺវាតាមយើងសម្លាប់យើងធ្វើតាបាន បើថាខ្វះការវិមគប់បើមិនគោរពបញ្ជាវិវាទៅតែងាប់បាទអត់ទុកទេបាទត្រូវតែងាប់ពីហោដូចរូបខ្ញុំម្នាក់នេះវាស្ទើរនឹងឡាប់ស្ទើរនឹងនៅស្ទើរនឹងរស់វារស់ដោយប្របាក់រត់មិនចេះចប់មិនចេះហើយបាទ
I have one more question before I pass the floor to the civil parties. In the excerpt I read to you, you indicated that you had received orders from your superiors to kill people. What types of people did your superiors order you to kill during the Khmer Rouge regime?
មនុស្សអត់ចាប់មានប្រភេទទេបាទអត់មានប្រភេទថាថ្មីថាចាស់ឲ្យតែធ្វើខុសបាទមិនថាតែអ្នកថ្មីទេឲ្យតែធ្វើខុសបាទឲ្យតែធ្វើខុសគឺគេសម្លាប់ហើយបាទគេហត់ថាលួចស្រូវលួចអង្គលួចដំឡូងអីដែលគ្នាឃ្លានទៅដកស៊ីដកអីតែគេតន់ងាប់ហើយមិនរស់ទេបាទអានេះដែលខ្ញុំដឹងខ្ញុំរស់នៅដឹងបាទជំនាន់នោះគឺខ្ញុំតាមដានមកគឺអញ្ចឹងខុសគ្មានខុសអីធំប្រមាណទេបាទខុសតែរឿងកាពះដែលសម្រាប់រស់រាល់ថ្ងៃបាទមនុស្សយើងតែឃ្លានហើយគឺអត់ដឹងឡាប់ដឹងរស់ទេវាអុយធំជាងពោះបាទអុយធំជាងបាយអុយធំជាងឃ្លានបាទមនុស្សត្រង់នឹងអត់ដឹងទេបាទអញ្ចឹងបានថាជំនាន់នឹងគឺវាមិនស្គាល់មនុស្សទេគឺជាងសត្វទៀតបាទជាងសត្វសត្វវាស្គាល់បើថាមនុស្សជំនាន់នោះអត់ស្គាល់ទេបាទលែងស្គាល់ខ្មែរលែងស្គាល់ឈាមខ្មែរអស់មនុស្សរស់នៅជំនាន់នឹងទល់ម្នាក់បានម្នាក់ម្នាក់គឺខ្ញុំថាតសាអាយុជីវិតមែនតែនថ្លៃណាថ្លៃមែនតែនពោះកានោះដកទាំងហើមក៏ចង់មិនដល់គ្នានិយាយអើយក៏គ្មានសិទ្ធិនិយាយកើតបាទនិយាយអត់កើតតែនិយាយដឹងពីខុសបាទ
Thank you for answering my questions today, Mr. Witness, Mr. President. I'll end our questions at this time.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à tous. Bonjour, Monsieur le Témoin. Je m'appelle Marie Guiraud. Je suis avocat du collectif des parties civiles et j'ai quelques courtes questions à vous poser sur votre rôle de milicien dans la commune de Kampotma et sur le rôle de cette milice sur le chantier du barrage du 1er janvier notamment. La première question que je voulais vous poser, c'est de savoir comment vous aviez été recruté pour être membre de la commune, de la milice de la commune.
បាទមនុស្សរើសជំនាន់នឹងធ្វើឆ្លកវាតលតែមនុស្សនឹងចេះគោរពវាចេះដឹងមិនដឹងថាវាក៏មិនទុកចិត្តយើងយើងក៏មិនទុកចិត្តវាម្ល៉េះហើយវារើសមនុស្សណាដែលឆោតដែលងងបានវាយោបាទមនុស្សចេះអត់យោទេបើមនុស្សណាឆោតមិនចេះអសរដូចខ្ញុំអីបានវាយោសម្រាប់វាកំពាក់កំពន់ទៅវាឲ្យធ្វើនេះធ្វើនោះទៅយើងអត់ដឹងអត់ដឹងខុសអត់ដឹងត្រូវដូចខ្ញុំអញ្ចឹងបាទអានេះសាកសីរបស់ខ្ញុំដឹងអញ្ចឹងបាទជំនាន់នោះ
Vous avez indiqué aux enquêteurs à l'époque, dans le document que nous citons depuis le début de la journée, en D166-156, ERN en français 004-02981, anglais 00330719, Khmer 00321785, vous indiquez avoir été envoyé à l'unité des combattants du district après le 17 avril 75. Ma question est la suivante. Fallait-il être un combattant pour être recruté parmi les miliciens ? ou d'autres personnes pouvaient-elles devenir miliciens? Quel âge en général avaient les miliciens qui rejoignaient les forces dont vous parlez? Vous venez d'indiquer que le recrutement se faisait au sein des unités. Est-ce que j'ai bien compris le sens de votre témoignage, que c'était donc au sein des unités de travail que se recrutaient les membres de la milice? Vous avez indiqué un petit peu plus tôt que les miliciens portaient des carabines. Y avait-il un quelconque entraînement pour les miliciens quand ils rejoignaient les rangs de la milice? Dans la même déclaration, donc au même ERN, vous avez déclaré concernant l'unité d'agents secrets dont vous faisiez partie qu'il y avait 12 membres. Pouvez-vous un petit peu nous expliquer quels étaient ces 12 membres, d'où venaient-ils, quel âge avaient-ils? Vous souvenez-vous de quelques éléments que vous pourriez partager avec nous aujourd'hui? Quand vous dites qu'ils étaient choisis, avait-il la possibilité et aviez-vous vous la possibilité de refuser d'entrer dans la milice?
ខ្ញុំអត់ធ្វើទេអត់ប្រមធ្វើទេប៉ុន្តែថាឥឡូវមិនធ្វើទៅខ្លាចពួកគេហ្នឹងខ្ញុំគេកំពុងតាមដានដែររឿងដូចថានៅជាមួយប្រជាជននឹងគឺខ្ញុំចេះណែអនុត់ប្រជាជនដែរអត់បាយអត់ទឹកឲ្យខ្ញុំដូចថាធ្វើចោលយកខ្ញុំធ្វើចោលយកបាទនិយាយអញ្ចឹងខ្ញុំធ្វើចោលដើម្បីលួចអង្គសម្រាប់ប្រជាជនដែរអត់ឃ្លានដែលគ្នាមកពីធ្វើការហើយគ្មានអង្គគ្មានអីមកផ្ទះ3កំប៉ុងអីវាសិតតែទឹកសោះឥឡូវខ្ញុំដាក់ Merci, Monsieur le témoin, de nous parler avec tant de franchise, pour reprendre votre mot. Le recrutement des miliciens se faisait-il de manière secrète? Est-ce que les villageois, les travailleurs, savaient qui était milicien et qui ne l'était pas?
Je vous
interromps, monsieur le témoin. Je me permets de vous interrompre parce que j'ai très peu de temps et je vous remercie de bien vouloir répondre de manière synthétique à mes questions, si vous pouvez. Je voulais vous citer un passage de l'audition de Hudson, dont nous avons parlé un petit peu plus tôt dans la journée, qui a été entendue le 3 juin 2015 devant cette chambre et qui indiquait, et je vous cite ce qu'elle a déclaré, ce qu'il a déclaré, « Nous ne pouvions pas savoir s'il y avait des miliciens parce que nous étions tous habillés en uniforme noir. » Est-ce que vous confirmez cela, qu'il était impossible de distinguer qui était milicien et qui ne l'était pas parce que les miliciens portaient tous des uniformes
noirs.
Est-ce que les miliciens étaient intégrés au sein des unités et travaillaient et surveillaient les travailleurs de l'intérieur à l'intérieur des unités? Je vous remercie. Lorsque vous avez été entendu par les enquêteurs, vous avez indiqué, donc je suis toujours à ce même document, le D166-156 et au même ERN cité précédemment, que vous aviez ordre, et je cite, de surveiller, contrôler le réfectoire et d'arrêter les gens qui volaient des choses. Est-ce que nous sommes d'accord que les miliciens avaient ordre de surveiller et de contrôler le réfectoire? Est-ce que cela faisait partie des tâches qui étaient assignées aux miliciens à l'époque?
ប៉ុន្តែខ្ញុំដែលខ្ញុំមើលការខុសត្រូវទីឆ្លោកហ្នឹងខ្ញុំមិនមែនធ្វើដូចអញ្ចឹងទេឲ្យតែមនុស្សខ្ញុំឲ្យស៊ីហើយខ្ញុំលួចឲ្យស៊ីហើយបាទឲ្យតែមនុស្សគោមនុស្សវាចង់រស់មិនមែនចង់ស្លាប់ទេបាទខ្ញុំលួចលាក់ឲ្យស៊ីទៅតាបានអីបីមនុស្សមកពីណាក៏ដោយរត់មកពីណាទៅហ៊ានរត់ពីទៅហ៊ានក៏ដោយរត់ពីពីមុខពីក្រោយក៏ដោយឲ្យតែចូលកន្លែងខ្ញុំគឺរស់បាទមិនស្លាប់ទេបាទ
Est-ce que les miliciens avaient pour responsabilité de chercher les personnes qui évitaient d'aller au travail et de les ramener au travail? Est-ce que cela faisait partie des tâches des miliciens?
ឆ្នាំ79 ឆ្នាំ80ហ្នឹងគឺប្រជាពលរដ្ឋគឺកាប់គ្មានសល់អត់មានរត់រួចទេបាទជាមួយដៃប្រជាជនដែលធ្វើមិនល្អគឺអញ្ចឹងខុសជើងយកជើងខុសដៃយកដៃដល់ពេលបរាជ័យទៅប្រជាជនកាប់ខ្ទេចរត់អត់រួចបាទអានឹងត្រង់ហ្នឹងការងារដែលយើងដាច់ខាតយើងធ្វើមិនពិចារណាចំពោះមនុស្សមនុស្សលោកខ្លួនមនុស្សដូចតែគ្នាមនុស្សដូចតែគ្នាយើងអត់ចេះពិចារណា ត្រង់នឹងដល់បរាជ័យដល់ធ្លាក់ចុះទៅអត់រួចដៃប្រជាជនទេបាទអត់រួចទេជំនន់នោះបាទប្រជាជនខឹងណាស់នេះជំនន់របបប្រល័យពូជសាសន៍នេះបើបងប្អូនណាកើតតន់បងប៉ុន្តែជំនន់នោះគឺស្លាប់អស់ច្រើនបាទនៅតែទេតន់ហើយក្មេងក្រោយនេះ
Je vous remercie pour revenir aux différentes tâches qui étaient exécutées par les miliciens. Je voudrais vous citer deux passages d'auditions de témoins et de parties civiles qui ont été entendus un petit peu plus tôt dans cette audience. Il s'agit toujours de Hout Seng, dont nous avons parlé. Le transcript est le suivant, E1-309.1. Et ce témoin déclare aux alentours de 9h30, et je vous cite, et je le cite, pardon, « Dans chaque village, il y avait des miliciens sous couvert qui surveillaient les activités des villageois et qui écoutait aux portes, sous la maison, particulièrement les gens du 17 avril. Les conversations étaient surveillées, les conversations de ces gens du 17 avril. Et ils vérifiaient particulièrement si ces personnes parlaient de la nourriture ou de la bouillie. Nous avons également, lors de cette audience, entendu une partie civile, Seng Sovida, et je me réfère ici au transcript E1-308.1, et cette partie civile a déclaré dans la matinée aux alentours de 10h36, il y avait également des miliciens dans les villages, ils surveillaient et surtout le peuple du 17 avril. Monsieur le témoin, lorsque vous étiez milicien, avez-vous pour responsabilité et tâche de surveiller particulièrement les gens du 17 avril?
ແລະទីហ៊ានប៉ូលីសទាំងអស់នៅក្នុងរបបលន់នល់ទាំងអស់ដល់ជំនឿបានមកនៅក្នុងភូមិនឹងខ្ញុំទៅក្តាប់ម្យ៉ាងទៀតបងប្អូនដែលគ្រោះថ្នាក់ដែលគ្រោះថ្នាក់ដែលត្រូវបាត់បង់ជីវិតវាមានម្ចាស់ទៀតវាមានឋានៈចាស់ដូចដល់អ្នកថ្មីដូចគ្នានេះវារាយការណ៍ទៅប្រាប់ឃុំទៅប្រាប់ឆ្លោកនេះដើម្បីសម្លាប់គ្នាឯងនេះអានេះដែលខ្ញុំនៅនឹងដឹងខ្ញុំតាមដានច្បាស់ มันเรียกการเอาโฉบเด้เวียดโนตเรียกให้คุมมวยนกมลอยเวียตํานาะตะគ្នាไอ้นึงเวียอาคลาสទៅเรียกថាអនុធ្វើតាហ៊ានអនុធ្វើប៉លីសអឺអនុធ្វើគិញចឹងទៅណែដែលដោយសារងាប់ដោយងាប់ចឹងរឿងអ្នកថ្មីតែគ្នាគាត់នឹងមិនមែនជាជួនចាស់ឯណាទៅតាមដានទៅរុករៀនអត់ទេតែគ្នាគាត់នឹងយកទៅយកធំចង់ឲ្យវាបែកបាក់សាមគ្គីអត់ទេ อันนั้นตรงนั้นเด้อันนี้แต่ខ្ញុំតាមដានខ្ញុំរស់នៅនឹងភូមិនឹងហើយដូចខ្ញុំនិយាយនឹងភូមិខងខ្សែខ្ញុំនៅតិចណាមនុស្សបាត់បង់ជីវិតគ្រូសិតតែគ្រូទាំងអស់បាទនៅរស់សពថ្ងៃដោយសារអីដោយសារចំហនេះដឹកនាំរឹងមិនអោយដកដាល់និយាយពីដកដាល់ស្នើខ្ញុំហើយខ្ញុំទៅប្រជុំហើយស្នើហើយស្នើទៀតស្នើថាត្រូវតែដកពីរនាក់ มามุกสัญญาโดยฐานิสาดจังดอกปีเนี่ยจังទៅខ្ញុំថានឹកក្នុងចិត្តខ្ញុំថាតើដកចុះដកឡើងមិនជួរនឹងងាប់ទេល្បិចវាឲ្យតែដកចុះដកឡើងគឺត្រូវតែងាប់ចឹងហើយខ្ញុំរឹងជាងហោខ្ញុំអត់ដកសិតតែគ្រូទាំងអស់បាទនៅភូមិខ្ញុំហើយខ្ញុំស្មានថាបើសិនទីកន្លែងនឹងបើសិនតែខ្ញុំកុំនៅគ្រូនឹងគឺអលីយបាទគឺអលីយគោះពីជាជន់ខ្លះគឺស្អប់ណាស់រឿងគ្រូបាទ
Je vous remercie. Je vous remercie, Monsieur le témoin, et la Cour prend bonne note de vos bonnes actions durant le régime du Kampuchea démocratique. J'ai une dernière question sur le rôle des miliciens. Et je vous cite un passage d'une audition d'un témoin qui est venu devant cette chambre le 26 mai 2015. Et je cite ici le transcript E1-305.1. Et cette personne parle du rôle des miliciens concernant les nouveaux mariés. Et je vais vous lire ce que cette personne a déclaré et je souhaiterais vous faire réagir par rapport à cette déclaration. Ce témoin indique: après mon mariage, les miliciens sont venus me surveiller. Ils sont venus voir si nous nous réjouissions, si nous avions célébré un rituel après le mariage, comme par exemple brûler de l'encens. Si l'on nous avait pris en train de brûler de l'encens, nous aurions été emmenés et exécutés. Ce témoin indique un petit peu plus loin dans la réponse suivante: ils sont venus me surveiller, moi et mon mari, pendant les premiers jours, et elle termine en indiquant: les miliciens venaient surveiller tous les nouveaux mariés. Comment cela se passait-il dans votre commune, monsieur le témoin? Est-ce que vous pouvez nous dire si les miliciens étaient effectivement chargés de surveiller les nouveaux couples qui se mariaient dans votre commune?
លោកប្រធានខ្ញុំថាសក្ខីកម្មរបស់សាស្ត្រស្រីនេះມັນឆ្លើយតបនឹងសំណួរទេសូមអរគុណបាទឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសម្រាប់ហើយអរពេលកាសសម្រាប់ចាប់ទៅពេលនេះទៅទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង 3 សូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចសម្រាប់ការសម្រាប់ការមានវិក្នុងមុខកំណាងដើមនឹងរំលឹកអស់ពេលហើយម៉ោង 3 សូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចសម្រាប់ការសម្រាប់ការ
មន្ត្រីរដ្ឋបាលតុលាការបានរំលឹកផ្ដល់កន្លែងសម្រាប់នៅបន្ទប់រងចាំសម្រាប់ប្រាក់ថ្លៃនឹងអ្នកជំនាញដល់សាក់ស្រីរូបនេះនៅក្នុងឡុងពេលឈប់សម្រាប់នឹងអញ្ជើញគាត់មកកាន់កន្លែងផ្ដល់សេវាកម្មរួមទាំងមេធាវីប្រឹក្សាបកគាត់នៅវេលាម៉ោង 3 សម្រាប់ចុះសូមជើងក្រោកឈរ